extremely good program. Just some words before we get started. Diane Milburn is checking where lunch will be, and there will be an announcement right before lunch on where it will be. Restrooms are this at this end of this corridor, or in the other wing to your left. And so, if you like, you can go either direction. Nick Nielsen has put together a tremendous program, and we're privileged to have today as our keynote speaker the Catalysis Society's 1994 F.G. Ciappetta Lecturer, Professor John Rooney. And Dick will introduce him at this time.
Professor John Rooney has had a distinguished career at Queen's University of Belfast, from whence he first graduated in 1957, and he received his PhD in 1960. His thesis work at that time was hydrocarbon reactions on silica alumina catalysts. Besides teaching at Queen's University, he's also worked there for 2 years under Charles Kimball and the late Francis Galt. During this time, he developed the pi bond theory of transition metal catalysis and discovered cation radical forming activities of acidic refractory oxides. He then spent 3 years as a lecturer at the University of Hull in the United Kingdom, returning to Belfast in 1965. In 1980, he was appointed professor of catalytic chemistry, which is his current position. Besides teaching thermodynamics, his main research interests are in the common mechanistic themes in heterogeneous and homogeneous catalysis. Some of the areas that he has worked in this general category involve novel hydrocarbon reactions on metals, such as deuterium exchange, hydrogenation, cyclization, bond shifts, and other similar reactions. This was work primarily done to develop and extend the five-bond theory and the idea that defect atoms are the active sites. Professor Rooney also has done work in acidic catalysts and parallels between homogeneous and heterogeneous catalysts. He has won several awards, including, of course, the 1994 Ciappetta Lectureship in Catalysis from the North American Catalysis Society. He has previously won the Mandela Medal of the Royal Society of Chemistry. He is a member of the Royal Irish Academy. He has numerous publications. Today, he's going to speak to us on the organic chemical probe approach to heterogeneous catalysis. Without further delay, I present you to Professor John Rooney.
Well, thank you, Dick, for your very kind remarks. I was delighted when I heard that I received the Ciappetta Lectureship because it's a very high honor and the Deacon recognizes such a role, which is very useful to me. I was a little bit of fear and trepidation. I the extensive trip around the USA because my Ireland is just so small and I'm not used to such distances. Coming here, I thought that the Tri-State Club and the other clubs, I thought that I would try and get across my general philosophical viewpoint of catalysis. And what I want to I'll illustrate this by the first two slides.
Keep going.
Sorry.
One more.
Okay.
No, they're going the wrong way.
They're going the wrong way?
Yes. The bottom one.
That's it. Thanks. Is the bottom button?
Yes.
I've divided the subject into two. In terms of approach, it's not a clean division, but at least it'll do for the sake of the argument at 100%. I've called it catalytic representatives in the first slide here. What I mean by by this is that we have strong bonding to the surface, basically virtually steady state surface reorganization, compound formation. Essentially all the valences of carbon and nitrogen and things like that, oxygen, the various catalytic processes, bonded into the surface, used in the bonding to the surface. Now here's spectroscopic and surface science techniques which have boomed in the last 20 years, are very valuable probes. But if the area that I want to concentrate on is the area that I want to concentrate on is an alternative area. I think the site densities are low. They're basically defects. I think the real turnover numbers are far higher than what we estimate from surface areas. Turnover numbers are something that we have difficulty, absolute turnover numbers, in assessing. The bonding of the intermediates to the surface is, I think, much weaker than people think, much weaker than the surface scientists project. The lifetimes are very short, so therefore they're difficult to see by direct spectroscopic techniques in many of the catalytic processes that I would be interested in. And these species, the tall man cycles, are ticking over so rapidly, and there's so few of them, you just literally don't see them. Now, in this area, I advocate, and it's not a new idea, is what's called the organic chemical probe approach. What you do here is you design a molecule to ask a serious question of the surface, and the molecule has to be sufficiently complex to contain enough functionality and structural information in order to ask the definitive question of the surface. And this is basically the approach I've been using all my lifetime, and I call this the organic chemical probe approach. It's not a new approach because it was used way before I started catalysis in 1957. I remember the great excitement when infrared was first applied at the conference in 1960 in Paris, the international conference, when it first discussed Bob Eichens and Co. And so there were essentially, before that there were no direct spectroscopic techniques, but now there are huge numbers of these techniques and spectacular success has been achieved with them. Could you go the other way?
Sorry.
I'm going ahead now, thanks. Next one. I want to illustrate this with an old problem out of the literature which worked on for about 10 years before I found the solution. And there were several other people, Keith Hall and others, have worked on this. If you take 1-1 diphenyl ethylene and add it to a silica alumina catalyst at room temperature and an inert solvent activated silica alumina paraffin, which is cyclohexane or benzene or whatever, you get this first nice yellow band here, 420 nanometers, and then rapidly after that grows in a beautiful blue species, 605 nanometers. And this grows quite intense. If you add a little water, this goes down and the other band goes up. People know what this band is. It's just a protonated substrate. You can do the same thing on acetic sulfuric acid, you see. So heterogeneous catalysis, homogeneous, get exactly the same sort of behavior. A mixture of basal acetic acid and conch sulfuric acid. People knew what this was, but they were very intrigued by this. Now, at that time, we had discovered cation radical formation, and one makes an ESR study on this. Yes, it's ESR active, this system, and there's a small density of cation radical, so people thought this blue species was a cation radical. But I, quite early on, convinced myself that it was diamagnetic, because one could add enough water to leave this quite intense, but destroy the paramagnetism. Go to the next slide, please. Go the other way.
This is impressive.
Yep. Matt, I hope you can see this. The majority of the chemistry that's happening here is that the diphenyl ethylene protonates and then it alkylates another olefin. The carbonium ion alkylates from this position on another olefin. You get this carbonium ion here, which in the acetic sulfuric acid mixture drops out as this olefin, but on the silica alumina surface undergoes an intramolecular alkylation and gives you the hydrindium. Essentially the whole product just ends up as the hydrindium. Now, on reflection one can see quite clearly that this line is not going to provide the blue species, because all of these carbonium ions are the same chromophore, so it should be yellow, this one as well. So there's a lot of speculation then among my group and by myself as to what was going on. So we started to think, well, suppose that at a certain stage you had a proton ship from here to here, and you had a methyl ship from then into the middle, and then you could get a carbonium ion like this and go on down this sequence. You'll have to extend conjugation, you see, to shift to longer wavelengths. And one could end up with this tetraphenyl methyl alene as a carbonium ion, you see, if you go down this series. But you'll require a proton shift and a methyl shift in order to get there. Well, to cut a long story short, we synthesized this. Yes, it absorbs about 520 nanometers longer wavelength, but it's not the blue species. So we were stuck with this very, very interesting puzzle. And it suddenly dawned on me one day that when one writes a carbonium ion like that, you're writing a canonical form. And if a canonical form has a reality, why not use the other canonical form with initial attack where the plus charge is out here in the para position? And that's exactly what happens. Para position here attacks onto this molecule and goes down this, it makes this. You now have a hydride, but you make a quinonoid species with a hydrogen here, which is extremely active. Drop that out, and you're into this species here, this carbonium ion here. Now this is the blue species. Forget about this for the time being, I'll come back to that. Go on to the next slide, please. This beautiful chromophoric entity, as I say, this is to enlarge the chemistry here, or to show you more clearly, this carbonium ion here adds on, eventually makes this, and you can get this off as an alcohol if you use water to eventually kill the carbonium ion. Abstract OH minus on the surface, and if you make this alcohol and add it back, and you get the carbonium ion. So we synthesized this in order to test our ideas, and it proved to be absolutely correct. If you make this alcohol, even on magnesium perchlorate, it turns magnesium perchlorate, anhydrous magnesium perchlorate, light blue. And it's a very nice indicator, actually, for acid catalysis, if anyone's interested in indicators. Now, you can see the attack is on the para position. And here's a very interesting historical example. The Gomberg free radical is triphenylmethyl radical. Triphenylmethyl radical is supposed to dimerize into hexaphenyl ethane. Now, about 6 or 7 years after I found the solution to this, we saw in the literature that somebody had shown that you don't make hexaphenylethane by dimerizing Gomberg's free radical. It's a very interesting historical point. It actually dimerizes through the para position, this position here. And that's actually the dimer, the Gomberg free radical, not the hexaphenylethane. Go to the next slide, please. But just a quick bit of synthesis, I went around and found a very convenient synthesis. This is easy to make by Grignard reactions, but it acylates exactly, or very selectively, at this para position, which turned out to be very fortunate, because then one could get high yield of this by simple chemistry, and then just another Grignard reaction onto this, and that made the alcohol that makes this indicator. Now, before leaving this little story, I haven't published this anywhere in the open literature, but although the work has been done 20 odd years ago, before leaving it, there's a very interesting aspect to this. You see, canonical forms are the true reality in chemistry, not resonance hybrids. It's an interesting aspect of this. That struck me very vividly after 7 years puzzling about this problem. Just to go back now, this arm of the thing here is independent of this slide. Steve Mutchins, but it doesn't matter. There's another old chestnut and classical problem in acid catalysis, and that's if you take triphenylmethane itself and put it onto silica alumina, you get the triptyl carbonium ion, which you can detect with its difficulty. Now, the immediate reaction is that the silica alumina surface Lewis acidity pulls out H minus and leaves you the triptyl carbonium ion. It doesn't go that way. It goes a much more subtle path. And the subtle path is that this was largely Keith Hall's work. Keith had found that the reaction requires proton acidity. It's augmented by the presence of oxygen. It's augmented by the presence of light. So you have to think of chemistry that will incorporate all of those. Now, we did various tests on this, and we found that it seems as if the way this reaction goes, you protonate the, first of all, on one of these phenyls, then you activate this carbonium ion with light. Under the action of light, you get an endothermic isomerization where H plus drops off at this point, and you end up with this quinonoid structure. And the final state is this quinonoid structure in the presence of oxygen and Bronsted acidity will drop out H minus here. And that's the way through to the triptyl carbonium ion. You see the subtlety of things. It's not the, the direct reaction is not not the case in point. But the, now the most general thing you see philosophically here is this. The species which was least abundant, less abundant in the diphenylethylene story, that was the initial carbonium ion, is the one that was catalytically competent. It makes 99.whatever% of the product, the pyrindium, which comes out as an inert stable compound. The species which builds up as the interesting chemisorptive complex, the blue species, is only involved in parts per million of the catalysis. There's an interesting juxtaposition here of ideas about the things that are doing the catalysis. And you see, we were hunting after this species, Keith Hall and others and myself, trying to identify it, and yet catalytically it's trivial. It's chemisorptive wise and chemistry wise quite intriguing. So the next slide, please. And out of this chemistry, we found a rather nice little synthesis of tetraphenylalanine, which was theoretically of interest in those days. We found that if you take if you take this compound here, this compound will protonate in liquid acid or in solid acids more readily than this compound, even though this is intrinsically the more stable carbonium ion. It goes by virtue of the leaving group is OH minus here, which makes water use, so the energy path is better for that than it is for that. Now, if you take a 50-50 mixture of these two, what you get is selectively that, then this adds onto this, and this step here, this is the crucial step, makes this selectively, and it drops out that all of them. And quantitative yield in acetic sulfuric acid mixtures. And then you can use that olefin. This olefin is tetraphenylpropylene, but that in itself is not necessarily a very interesting olefin. But if you take tetraphenylalanine, was of interest for various theoretical purposes and experimental purposes. You just have to brominate and dehydrobrominate, and you're into tetraphenylalanine. And prior to that, there were a lot of very complex synthesis. So one can use the sort of information out of the catalysis in order to do synthesis. Bit of the next slide, please. This very that was all work away 20 years ago. This is very recent work, just to show you that this type of stuff is still quite relevant. Triphenylamine will make a cation radical extremely readily on silica alumina surfaces. Nice blue complex, which you can detect with ESR, and it's quite characteristic. It dimerizes spontaneously again by this type of dimerization onto the neutral molecule. Through the power opposition here, drops out these two hydrogens onto the action of oxygen. You end up with good yields of the tetraphenylbenzidine, which you can easily detect. Now, we were interested, and you'll see this later on in the lecture, on platinum magnesium oxide catalysts. There's a lot of interest from Belgium and one thing and another, so we're interested in these. And we're making chloride free platinum magnesium oxide, and then some platinum magnesium oxide which had chlorine in it from the chloropatinic acid of synthesis to catalysis. We found that there was a distinction, this was work with John Clark, a good friend down in Dublin, that there was a distinction in the behaviour of paraffins on the chlorided stuff and the chlorine-free catalyst in terms of reforming paraffins from hydrogen, small paraffins. The chlorine-containing material tended to attack the paraffin at the terminal positions, whereas the other stuff was without chlorine, was indiscriminate. And we found that this compound here, in fact, could distinguish the sites. This put this on the chlorine-containing platinum magnesium oxide, and it's only a few percent of chlorine, I think. One got immediately strong cation radical formation, and this, without chlorine, no cation radical formation at all. So here you have a chemical probe diagnosing the sites, you see, rising out of this cation radical stuff. Could have the next slide, please. Now, this is just to summarise the site densities, incidentally, in all of this work, and you can easily do it by titration, ESR estimation, all the rest. The site densities are never more than about 10 to 11, 10 to the 12 per square centimetre, which is quite low, you see, when you think about it. And this is borne out in other areas of aluminium chemistry, especially the gamma-alumina work with Keith Hall and co. Selective exchange reactions that Keith and Joe Hightower was involved as well, and others over the years. on cycle alkenes, double bond shift and selective exchange, and you could use these things as poisons, reversible, but you could try to at the sites. My main point here is that the site densities are very low. Again, very low. Now, could have the next slide, please. This raises a very interesting question. This is a statement by Paul Weiss out of a paper, I think 10 years ago, with Nature, where he was reflecting on the silica, the zeolite caps, and he was saying, you see, that aluminium at levels which are virtually contaminant levels, ignored by the experimenter, are often catalytically very active on zeolites. The turnover numbers for several hydrocarbon reactions equal or exceed familiar enzymatic turnover values. Now this intrigues me because I wonder, is this, one tends to think of enzymes as special, or you can turn the thing around and say, are enzymes the normal, and are we taking the wrong view of heterogeneous catalysis for most of the time? But that's drastic reactions. I'm not going to extend the argument to like more drastic things like artificial top synthesis and methanation, for fairly selective reactions. Because the whole area of the refractory oxide catalyst with aluminium and the site densities are obviously very low. And are these sites just defects? Is there as low as that? Could the next slide, please? Well, the situation in the acid catalytic area is not too bad. When you come to metals, it's a real jungle. Bob Burwell used to talk about an organometallic zoo, and he's quite right. This is the old Horiuti Pelniani mechanism. I want to review work over the past 50 years briefly in order to sort of tell you what I think of the Horiuti Pelniani mechanism at the present time. The asterisk is a symbol just to mean there's a valency here and another valency here that's used in the surface. The 1-2 diazoxide species is the old famous alpha beta processes called, so called by my mentor Charles Kimball. Could the next slide, please? What I call it, the organic probe molecules have been used many times here by other people, so it's not a new concept. You see, this is work by Jerry Smith and others, a very nice piece of work. You can get the optically active form of this compound fairly cheaply, aponamine, and you can hydrogenate upon metal surface. At the same time, it will double bond shift. If it double bond shifts, you see it makes the other enantiomer, so you can use a polarimeter and very easily sort of detect what's going on. And the rate constants for this and this are the same, so you have a nice, simple, elegant system. Now, and this, they titrated with CS2. Now, they came to a conclusion that the sites are corners and edge atoms and things like that. You know, what I would call the, I call corner edge, you see a defect, something in a plate of Mats Reger. So, now this, the double bond is missing out of this in the middle, but this is Burwell's famous example of tertiary butyl acetylene hydrogenating on a metal surface. And Bob used to sort of pose the question, now how does the thing get close to the surface if it's a flat surface in order to hydrogenate? And he used to think of the acetylene bond as actually lifting the metal atom that's stuck the proud out of the surface, you see, by certain frac. The other way of looking at it is that it doesn't hydrogenate on all the surface, exposed surface at all, but only hydrogenates on a very limited number of sites. Could we go on to the next slide, please? This is again, classical work, a famous piece of studies, in a way. If you take the ethane exchange on platinum film, these are initial product distributions. The molecule has only been chemisorbed once, so it rattles about with this alpha-beta process, and some of the molecules can exchange all the hydrogen atoms before they come off the surface. So you can use the distribution to look into the chemistry. Now you see there's a nice U-shape here, you see. This would be about 150 degrees centigrade, minimum down here in the middle. So there's a falling distribution and there's a rising distribution, overlap simultaneously. Now, you can make any type of polycrystalline platinum you like and you'll get the same sort of behaviour. But the result that really amazed me was when a paper that Gabor Summerjai published using platinum on one single crystal. It was at the temperature of reaction 100 degrees higher than the polycrystalline materials. But he got exactly the same distribution. At that time, Gabor was very sold on the philodynes and things like that as catalytically competent species. and he was suggesting that Philidale was involved in this, but it's not. I mean, Kemble's, you can take it for granted, Kemble's analysis is absolutely 100% right from the word go, 50 years ago when he and John Anderson first did that. Now, you have a very interesting question here. If you want to have a falling distribution or rising distribution at one and the same time, you have to have two different types of sight. So, what are the two different types of sight on a single piston? The other thing that's important about this result is that Gert Ertel and Boudar, Michel Boudar, and others of Alec Bell and Cole have shown that the single crystal is a true microcosm of the polycrystalline catalyst for nitrogen fixation. And the same is true for CO oxidation. So they've shown that via into those two areas. Too important. This is important. This area here is the same. Here's again the same sort of thing. Go to the next slide, please. Well, you can Kemble without these arrows analyzes the thing in terms of statistics. I put arrows in to try and see could I get spillover from sites A to sites B and published a paper on this. So it's just that you have sites with a falling distribution and you have sites with a rising distribution, and you might as well. Simply, you can add the thing up as if you had a mechanical mixture of two catalysts, two independent catalysts, to get the distribution. But it has to be more subtle than that, you see, because my instinct tells me if you can go 150 degrees, 250 degrees, and the distribution is basically the same, like, why aren't the sites altering in terms of their relative densities to get the same distribution? So it's still a mystery there. Go to the next slide, please. Now, this is the, again, you'll see the U-shaped, call the U-shaped distribution. Here's a W, you see, with cyclopentane. This is classical stuff, too. Kemble. U up to D5, and then another U up to D10. The molecules stop exchanging at D5 because that's one side, one face of cyclopentane, obviously. If it can't roll over, it can't get up the other side. So we've got two possibilities in this chemistry, even at low temperatures, roll over and spill over. Now, what is rolling over here? An intriguing question. Next slide, please. My interpretation of this is the old pi bond mechanism. It's alkyl olefin the alkyl olefin interconversion, just the same as in homogeneous catalysis. One metal atom doing the reaction. There's an available excess pool of hydrogen in these or deuterium in these reactions. We use in these exchanges about 50 to 1 deuterium to organic. Now the molecule has to sort of detach at this point to see it can't go any further in exchanging on to the only cis ligand addition or cis ligand addition and insertion, so or abstraction, so you can't get beyond 5, you see, unless you cut the pi bond and roll the thing over. Now the question of the nature of this rollover, well, we're all going to have to wait for a couple of years as to the nature of this process. But the next slide. Here one sort of ties, now what way can we sort of work out the nature of the mechanism? Bob said you need eclipsed hydrogens, bisonyl eclipsed hydrogens. Now here in norbornium is a classic, it exchanges two hydrogens at one go. It can't go to there, see it's not eclipsed, it's skewed. But also, my theory, you couldn't go there anyway because it would be an anti-Brett olefin, just to say for the best. So, both theories would explain D2, both Bob's theory and mine of the bonding. But I went on to make this thing, which you can make catalytically, it's not my synthesis, but you can make it catalytically by norborne dimerization on homogeneous catalysts. This thing has so strained to make an olefin here, you see, it's a good test because it sets up twos, you see, this and the eclipse twos all around the molecule. Do the exchange and you find the distribution is just simple. Here it's multiple, here it's simple. So, and the obvious conclusion is because it can't form the pi bonds. Next slide, please. These are just a series and you needn't pay too much attention to them. You just quickly go down them. You can do this one, you see, and if it's going to exchange both sides of this C5 ring, it has to go to, and it will form this, and this you do find, if you pull this stuff out, you find it. During the exchange reaction, you've gone from the endo to the axo, thermodynamically more stable isomer, and it can only go through something in my view like that. It actually is getting detached, it's flipping over and hydrogenating from the other side. We went through a series of molecules like this. This one exchanges on all set faces, all hydrogens initially, on that molecule exchange, and you have to go through something like that to do it. This one only exchanges in one face because you have a dish here, you see. And the dish, if you form a double, you can form a double bone in this thing, but it's very strained. The dish can't flatten out and sort of bend back the other way, you see. And so you can't go through the planar part of the dish, so you can't get the exchange on both faces there. So that, to me, sort of pretty convincing of the ideas, the pi bond theory of the elephant and these things. The infrared actually took 20 years to catch up on this in terms of proving the depth of the pi bond, of course, involved a significant Norman Shepherd's work from metal catalysis. That was the direct spectroscopic approach. Because of various difficulties, theoretical difficulties. Could go on to the next slide, please. Now, there's another result that has really intrigued me in recent years. We and Charles Kimball had all knew that you had to have a pool of excess deuterium always available, faster than any other step in the game, you see, in order to handle the statistics. And the statistics work out, you see, the kinetics and everything else. So we assumed that the deuterium, the paraffin was coming onto the surface, you see, but the deuterium is also coming down onto the surface and then laterally scrambling very rapidly back and forth. We know the deuterium, hydrogen-deuterium exchange on its own is much faster than the paraffin exchange. So we assumed that there's this rattling back and forth on the surface. But I turned to titanium oxide platinum catalysts some years ago because of the Simpson effect. And the Simpson effect tells you that a strong Simpson effect, you get negligible uptake of hydrogen on the platinum. So you have an interesting story here, what will happen to the exchange reaction. The exchange reaction went down by a factor of 20 or 50 fold in weight. The hydrogen uptake factor had gone down by at least 1,000 by our titration measurements. But the exchange was exactly the same distribution, same U-shaped distributions as before. And this sort of result stops you in your tracks, because if the hydrogen uptake is negligible on its own, and the paraffin exchange is still going on, it must first of all be simply by a few defects that one's getting the paraffin exchange. The second thing is that you haven't got a pool of hydrogen on the surface, available through the surface. You haven't got this vast pool of hydrogen available to you. The pool has to be somewhere in terms of the kinetics, but the only place the pool is in the gas phase. The pool's there, it's in the gas phase. So it makes you realise that there's another alternative, very efficient way, more efficient way of doing exchange, and that is that you have a pi-bonded olefin like this to a metal, and in comes a molecular deuterium, X, H or D here, a weak bond to the metal, and then one goes on to the hydrocarbon, and one stays on the metal, and then if you take a H instead of a D, the H can combine with the D and off you go again, you see, go back to this. So you can exchange the paraffin without having to have all this latter sort of mixing up H and D, you see. The whole thing is doing it efficiently right from the gas phase onto the one side. So that's the conclusion out of that. Could I go to the next slide, please? This now shows some recent work and then the scenario that we're currently very interested in. The fact that you can alter the distributions by using various supports, and one of the supports that alters the distribution is magnesium oxide. That's the classical distribution there for gamma luminous supported platinum. Magnesium oxide as a support pushes the distribution up to D10. This is the Derwent catalyst which we synthesize. It does the same thing. So it goes up to D10 significantly. That means the alkyl reversal is very significant on platinum magnesium oxide. It means you're driving towards olefin. And that, you see, is in the right direction, dehydrogenation, if you want to aromatize, and that's what Derwent's claiming, you see, with that catalyzer. That platinum magnesium oxide is a more selective and clean and good aromatizer of paraffins. So the exchange reactions were bearing this out. But what I'm interested in is what is the magnesium oxide doing to the platinum? I suggest at this stage magnesium oxide being a base is just donating electrons into the platinum, but that's as far as we've got. And that's controlling the alkyl reversal parameters on highly dispersed platinum. Could go on to the next slide, please. Now, just a summary of the Horiuti Polanyi thing. And you can see that over the 50 years, various questions come in now that single crystal of platinum is a true microcosm conventional alkyl reversal to pi bond alkene, rollover certainly of the alkene, spillover is another possibility of intermediate alkene. After all, there's spillover and dual functional reforming catalysis, you see, at not too much higher temperature. So why not have spillover from one metal site to another as well. Direct reaction of metal alkyl and or metal alkene with H2 or D2 is another. This part of it. And then very few sites seem to be active. And you can alter the alkyl reversal parameters. So that sums up sort of kind of the Horry-Polanyi situation, the alpha beta process. We come to higher temperatures. Next slide, please. Higher temperature catalysis is a real jungle. Higher temperatures, the alpha beta process in palladium platinum so fast you can't even. The thing's just swamped out, and so normally deuterium is no use there as a probe. But you've all these other reactions like hydrocracking, homologation, and 1-2 bond shift isomerism, 1-5 and 1-6 cyclizations, etc. So it's very, very difficult to work out mechanism here. Now, Francois Beau, who was a very good friend of mine, worked at Strasbourg, died unfortunately 12 years ago at an early age. Francois and I used to sit late at night sort of debating as what to do. He turned to C13 and he did a lot of very good work with C13 labeling. C13 shows you the complication of the reaction, the multi-static nature of the reaction. It doesn't show you the mechanism. I used to argue with Francois about this. You need to know how many deuteriums are dropped off if you really want to get out the many hydrogens are dropped off in the crucial steps. So the next reaction that I wanted to sort of kind of look at in detail was 1-2 bond shift. There was a lot of debate about that. Next slide, please. Before going on to that, cobalt, this is work done by Francois and myself at Caen. He was in Normandy before he went on to Strasbourg. If you put quality, these were his model compounds that he brought to Belfast in 58. If you put these on a cobalt film and try the exchange, you find that there's no exchange until you get zero order evolution of CD4. Now what's happening here is that, and then you get selective exchange, multiple exchange, and selective demethylation. What's going on here, you see, is that the cobalt takes the first molecules of hydrocarbon and takes them right in, makes individual carbon atoms. And then you have to heat the thing up to a reasonable temperature in order to get a steady state tick over where methane is going off, in order to give you a site which will give you selective exchange of the paraffin. So you see, this is this idea of Tolman cycles, one penetrating the other. The Tolman cycle making the methane is controlling the other Tolman cycle for the selective reaction. And this is what makes catalysis by metals such a formidable problem. You have several interdependent Tolman cycles, you see, operating here. Now, on platinum, this isn't the case because platinum doesn't get catalytic reactions without carbine and platinum. It's certain selective. So they're well-chosen models. Here, the cobalt is carbining extensively before it causes a selective reaction. We'll go on to the next slide, please. I just want to, now, neopentane isomerism. John Anderson found neopentane isomerized isopentane on a platinum film alone, no acidity required. A reaction has intrigued people for many years. This is my explanation of it, that you only need to drop off one hydrogen and you can call it a metal cystic free radical rearrangement. That's what I like to call it. Now, the transition state is a subtle transition state. It's a half reaction species here, the methyl half bond. It's a pi bonded complex. And I'll go to the next slide, please. The Chatt-Dewar-Duncanson model for pi bonding olefin gives you a nice representation of how this thing goes, because you have an all bonding orbital here, and then you have a net anti-bonding orbital here. The methyl atomic coefficient here doesn't make any contribution because it's net bonding and anti-bonding. So this is just net bonding in the Walsh orbitals for a three-center species. It gauges the pi orbital here, and you've got the d pi orbital is stabilizing this anti-bonding orbital, which contains the third electron, the free radical. You can put an electron right over into the metal if you want to, but you're only mine, you see, as well. But I'm not prepared to discuss that sort of detail. But this will explain why you get bunch assisted free radical rearrangements from metals. Now, as it so happens, there's an area of enzyme catalysis, cobalamin, cobalt carbon. It's the cofactor in vitamin B12. Doesn't function, you get pernicious anemia. There are 10 bond shift reactions there. And one of them, I think is on the next slide. This is a key one where you get a free radical. There's free radical in chemistry involved in it as well, that's absolutely established. The cobalt takes the free radical, and apparently there's a 1-2 shift of hydroxyl onto the terminal carbonyl there, and then you get the 1-2 diol becomes a 1-1 diol and then eliminates water and makes corresponding aldehyde, and this is the chemistry. Now, the famous French theoretical chemist Salem published a paper putting forward this mechanism about 6 or 7 years after we published our mechanism. The first was published by my student at Miami, Miami Conference, I believe. It's exactly, theoretically, the same mechanism. The interesting thing is, you see, that Salem, in fact, wasn't aware that we had published the same mechanism prior for heterogeneous catalysis, and I wrote him a letter, and he was very kind to listen, but it shows that some different areas of science, you see, the lack of content. So there's the same mechanism as benign zinc catalysis. Okay, the next slide, please. Well, this is a mechanism as much involved. Perhaps I'll go favour the metallocyclobutane. This is an antithesis reaction for doing bond shift. But I'm pretty well convinced that on platinum this mechanism is negligible. This is through carbenes and carbines. You would see a lot of literature about that. I don't think carbenes and carbines play much role at all in the bond shift reactions on platinum. You can actually get a certain amount of this on nickel and palladium bond shift, not on platinum access energy. Cut off, rotate the isobutene and then add it back. The same steps are involved in cracking and homologation. Go to the next slide, please. Well, we ran through a whole series of model comps. The one before that just earlier. The one before that, please. Could you just get back to the one before that? We ran through just, and don't pay too much attention to it. Proto-adamantane, adamantane, and all the rest of it. This is homo-adamantane to 1 meter. We ran through a whole series of these, and you can't apply a metallocyte butane mechanism at all. And you get bond shift, very clean bond shift in all of these. This one here is a beauty because this bond here shifts over to here, and there's no way, like it's an internal thing. You can make the free radical there, you see it shift across the anti-periplanar relationship that you need. Remember, these weak legs sitting above the high bond. So it fits in with all the free radical chemistry you want. And these all go, you see, very, very sweetly and cleanly on platinum palladium surface. Next slide, please. Well, sorry, there was one there, the one with the acid, yeah. I always hankered after the idea of using deuterium to sort of prove up on these mechanisms. And this model substrate here, you see, can't do alpha-beta multiple exchange with alpha-beta process, but it can cyclize across here, 1-5, and does do so, and makes this. It does two bond shifts into these two products here, one a near pentyl bond shift and the other one a methyl bond shift. And one can use gas liquid chromatography mass spectrometry to fish out all the products. You get cracking and everything else going on here, you see, at the same time. And see where the deuterium distribution starts. You see, if you haven't multiple exchange to start with in the parent, where does the exchange start? And we find the exchange in the cyclic compound here, this compound here, starts at D0 and gives you a maximum multiple exchange of 2, as it should do, because there's only 2 bisphenyl hydrogens that are capable of exchanging there. And the fact that it starts at D0, you see, proves that the minimum requirement for making a cycle is just drop off 2 hydrogens, and you can make the cycle on that. And you can call that sort of a reductive elimination in organometallic jargon, if you want to, but these reactions are known. The bond shift, you see, the products here we analysed, they should go up to 3, up to 11, if you count the hydrogens available by the alpha-beta process, and up to 11 you get. But we found, and the interesting point is, it starts at 1, distribution starts at 1, which shows that you only need to knock off 1 hydrogen in order to get bond shift. If it started from the carbene mechanism, it would unquestionably start at D2. So that was the only case where I was able to use deuterium at the higher temperatures. But the next... Well, again, sort of mechanism and synthesis. Can you use the mechanism to synthesize? At that time in Belfast, a very good organic chemist working with me, Tony McCurvey, who are interested in making these compounds here. It was a game with Paul Schleyer, who was also interested in making them. Now, these two are easy to make by cheap materials. This one's difficult, and this one here. And we were trying to beat Schleyer, you see, to these two. So I told McCarty, you can put four Caravan mountains onto this one here. I guarantee if you put the four on right and pass it over platinum, catalyst, and hydrogen, you will make this lad here. So 3 months, no further question about it. 3 months, McCarty came back, he says, I've got your substrate. Not only have I got your substrate, but I've got four Caravan mountains on this face, and I've got four on here. I've doubly homologated the thing. Next slide, please. And he came back, don't worry about all the details, this was a synthesis. He came up, this was the compound here with a double bond, and he said to me, well, I hydrogenate the double bond for you. I said, no, father, I'll just pass this in platinum, it'll hydrogenate anyway, over a conventional platinum catalyst. And we got beautiful crystals at this side of the other end of the reactor. Just a simple crude flow reactor, hydrogen, about 300 degrees, and you get the, that was the first synthesis of tetramontane. On to the next slide, please. But the, oh, this is just to show you the mechanism. Just think of one face here now. These compounds have always got chair faces, you see. So just think of this one chair face. Here's the four Caravan atoms, you see. Add on one hydrogen, and then do a cyclization across from there to there, you see. And then the next stage is you do a bond shift, a 1-2 bond shift from here to here. And that's your bump to adamantane. It's not too well drawn. It's even more than I do. You're home to adamantane. Now, cold adamantane to adamantane is about 12 kilocalories exothermic. They're very selective. Yeah. These are thermodynamic 6, as you all know. So you don't get much cracking and very nice clean reactions on metals. Next slide, please. The daddy of them all, though, in synthesis, this recent one using metals, and this is by Prinz back in Germany. Leo Paquette spent God knows how many years trying to synthesize with beautiful chemistry. Very G. This dodecahedron. And Prinz back in recent years started off with this, which is dirt cheap. Dehydrogenate, you get that. It immediately undergoes a spontaneous double Diels-Alder and makes this. The C4 ring undergoes a retro 2 plus 2 when you heat it. And he used our methodology. He just passed this, it's called Pagodian, trivial name, passed this over platinum or palladium and hydrogen, using our methodology for synthesis. It undergoes a retro Diels-Alder, a 2 plus 2, a retro 2 plus 2 here, and then hydrogenates these faces. When you do this and make a model, this point here is very close to this point. And the free radical, I think this must be a free radical reaction then. It makes that, so that's the sense, 2-3 state synthesis. And it has to be a free radical view. I think free radical should be considered more in heterogeneous catalysis than been in the past. We did a few experiments and published a few papers. People don't seem to be spin trapping of free radicals downstream and see what you get coming out of hydrocarbon reactions and metals. We've gone to the next slide, please. Well, that's how am I doing for time?
You're in fine.
Okay. That is the synthesis part. And I want to sort of talk about a thing that's new in this game. Subtle polar factors in catalysis. It so happened just by sheer fluke we had a bad palladium catalyst. It wouldn't exchange adamantane, so it wouldn't crack CH bonds at the reasonable normal temperatures, 100 degrees centigrade or thereabouts. But when we put this alcohol, which is a proto-adamantane with a methyl over here, put this over the surface, we found immediately we got the product, the 1-methyl adamantane, which is the stable. There's two isomers, 1 and 2-methyl. The methyl can be here or here. We found this, the stable isomer. Now the chemistry is quite simple, you see, if you think of this as a polar, it pulls out OH minus, you have a carbonium ion here, and you get the 1-2 bond shift, and it goes over from there, it's highly exothermic shift, and then H minus adds back. H minus is coming from the hydrogen, you see, in the hydrogenation. So that's a polar mechanism that's operating. But to our surprise, when we used a normal palladium catalyst, which is very good at exchanging adamantane, we didn't get the thermodynamically stable product, we got the other one. The next slide, please. We've got, instead of getting that product, we've got mainly that, the 2-methyl, which is in fact thermodynamically less stable. And what is happening here is that you're getting homolytic fission here, you see. And when you get homolytic fission, this point here is not good for bond shift, the tertiary is not good for bond shift. The palladium is good at doing the alpha beta process along here, so it runs along here to here very rapidly. And then you get a very symmetrical 1-2 bond shift of this metal-assisted free radical rearrangement. So the metal's switching about from here to here, and this group can switch about. when you get the palladium over to this point, as it will happen in the exchange processes along the chain, then you have a ternary center here. The ternary centers are easier to shift than the tertiary center. So this then shifts over from here to here. So you shift that over and you find this is the product. Shifts away from the ternary, leaves that as a tertiary. And then hydrogenates off the surface. So you see here the organic molecule, quite a complex organic molecule, is diagnosing a very subtle aspect of the game, that there is you can have heterolytic and homolytic fission on a palladium catalyst, and that this controls the chemistry. Go on to the next slide, please. This is another example of an ICI copper catalyst, which quite a very active catalyst. If you hydrogenate this protatom antinol, you see it's set up if you get a carbonium ion there for a shift from here to here. If you hydrogenate it on the ICI copper, no carbonium ion chemistry just went through for that. But if you did it on a bad copper catalyst without specifying why it was bad, what in fact we found was that we got other products which were all adamantane products. And that meant that, in fact, that at some intermediate stage this is becoming charged and this is shifting over, and then you end up with these products, you see. So here you have a diagnostic of maybe it's copper 2 in one case and copper not in the other case, you see. Different subtleties in the transition states. The more polar catalysts seem to be the less active as well. It just seems to be general rule. Next slide, please. Now that just summarises what I'm trying to say. It's the way of attack, homolytic or heterolytic, seems to be important in governing cell activity. I think this could become a very important feature as we go on into attempting more delicate selective reactions, fabricating catalysts. Next slide, please. Now this is an interesting one. If you take norbornadiene on palladium or platinum, standard catalyst in hydrogenate, all you'll get is norbornene and norbornene. But if you do it on a copper catalyst, this is the ICI copper catalyst, you get nortricycline as well as norbornene, and you get in fact about three times the amount of that. And if you look at the mechanism is something along these lines, and this has been proven homogeneously as well by direct spectroscopic techniques for other systems. This dihydrogen comes in here, there's a polar transition state develops. If you have norbornene like that, then this carbonium ion center whips across here, and this forms the home alloy rearrangement, they call it, goes to that, and then the hydrogen adds on there and you go into nortricycline. So you're diagnosing a polar transition state on the copper, which is not there on the palladium and platinum. The polarity in the transition state is important in the copper. Go to the next slide, please. And there's just an example out of recent work with very good spectroscopic work, which has actually shown the weak state of hydrogen on copper chromium carbonates doing exactly this type of chemistry. Taube is suggesting similar mechanisms for homogeneous osmium hydrogenation of ketones and things like that in some recent literature. Lack of form of hydrogen. Now that just summarizes again that you can have a more heterolytic type of transition states and more homolytic on the metal surface, and this will control the control the cell activities. We go on to the next slide. We found that methanol synthesis catalysts, all methanol synthesis catalysts that seem to be anyway selective, or make nortricycline, norbornadiene. So there you have an organic test for a methanol synthesis catalyst. We find that silver alumina is inert for hydrogenating norbornadiene, but silver zirconia is active for hydrogenating norbornadiene and makes nortricycline. And there have been claims at Budapest, the Budapest meeting, that silver zirconia is active in hydrogenating CO2 and CO. So there seems to be a bit of a tie in there that's worth following up. On to the next slide. Next one, please. How am I for time? Okay, Jim? I'm okay for a few minutes?
Yeah, so you've got 15 minutes if you'd like.
Okay, that's fine. Mm-hmm. This is something I'm very pleased with, actually. I teach thermodynamics. I'm not an organic chemist. I teach thermodynamics. I've been teaching it for years and years. And the more I teach it, the more I realize that very little I know about it. The second law is a real mystery. The There's a thing called the compensation effect in catalysis. It's been there for 70 years, and it's an old chestnut where you find that if you plot the Arrhenius parameters, there's a nice linear relationship between log A and E. Now, this is a beauty out of Wolfgang Sacker's work, a recent paper. He took zeolites loaded with metal, and he finds a compensation effect, beautiful one, you see, over something like 200 kilojoules. That's a fantastic range of energy, you see. And we found one as well. So we're of the same sort of type in some of our work, and we were very sort of interested in what is the explanation of the compensation effect. You find it with the same substrate. This was hydrogenolysis of neopentane and a family of similar catalysts. Or you can turn the thing around and you can use the same catalyst and a family of similar substrates. The next slide, please. And this is a hydrogenation of various nitroalkanes, again, nice compensation. You can find it homogeneously in homogeneous catalysis, very, very widespread. Homogeneous acid catalysis and base catalysis and all the rest of it. Next slide, please. Now, a chap called Connor here in the USA used the Henry Irons equation and said to expand the equation like that, and the compensation effect, he has a very nice paper about 10 years ago with Jay Cattell on this. Because log A is related to that, and E is related to that, in a linear fashion, and if delta G is constant, then there's a linear relationship between that and that, you see, so there's a linear relationship between that and that. And that is the theory, using the Irving equation. The trouble with this theory as it stood, I couldn't see with one manifold that K double dagger, that delta S and, double dagger and delta H double dagger could vary over 200 kilojoules. I could see it varying over 2, but not 200. That was the problem theory. I like Connor's treatment otherwise. The next slide, please. It dawned on me then, one morning I woke up at 4 o'clock and it dawned on me, yeah, we always think of chemical equilibrium in kinetics between the reactants and the transition state, but equilibrium is first and foremost a physical thing. Proper distribution of energy and matter. So if you think of a physical equilibrium, okay, I can have that as a physical equilibrium, but how far back can I go? I can run another physical equilibrium in here, maybe another one further back, and then I can sort of say I can take reactants plus catalysts and have a physical equilibrium right over with the transition state. And when I did this, then I realized that the K double dagger in the Irving equation can now be elaborated to become a composite K. And this is rather interesting consequences. Could we go to the next slide, please? This is just to show that if delta G is constant, essentially, you will have this is general, actually, basically general in thermodynamics. You have the Gibbs-Helmholtz equation, this can often be constant. But as Connor was claiming, it's basically constant in the transition state, delta G double dagger. And because of that, if it's constant, then this can vary, and that's where you get the linear relationship, you see. But in statistical thermodynamics, you can get a very good argument as to why, because this, for adsorption, you see, is basically the difference between the quotient, which is the difference between partition functions, a multiple of partition functions for the free state and the adsorbed state. And it doesn't vary very much, even if the heat of adsorption varies. And that makes this thing fairly constant. So you can then have a relationship where that, and that will vary in a linear fashion. Now let's look now at the next slide. In terms of the K adsorption, you see, I can put the K adsorption in now, you see, and say the K experimental for my catalysis is the pre-exponent of this KT over H factor. And then the K adsorption and the K double dagger. Now, K adsorption, you see, will come out of the Langmuir coefficients. And we see it's going to become a nice wedding of Langmuir theory and Irving theory, you see, for a new insight into catalysis. You expand this now, you see, you've got delta S for adsorption, delta S for activation, and delta H for adsorption. And it's the variation of these two laddies for the reactants that's causing the big compensation effect. Next slide, please. This is just to extend this in terms of Langmuir theory, you see. Theta, surface coverage, unimolecular, can be extended in terms of the gas phase pressure. These are the Langmuir coefficients. The rate, bimolecular reaction, which is the one Sacker had, hydrogenation of hydrogenolysis of neopentane. You'll have a bimolecular one like this. Now this is a very intriguing one. The next slide, please. When you look at this one, you can have the thing is by a second order, weakly adsorbed in both entities. Key explanation is that. But the one that's really interesting is the one where the one is strongly adsorbed and one is weakly adsorbed, and you get this sort of relationship with line work. So yeah, out of this then comes a delta H, you see, from this equilibrium constant, which is minus, but this delta H, you see, from a strongly adsorbed thing is also minus, so you have a minus minus on this one, you see. You have a minus there and you have a minus minus here. This minus minus can be quite large because you're dealing with a strongly adsorbed thing here, so it can augment the E value and push the E value in catalysis away up to an apparent value, the value you measure, which is way above the what you call the true value for a conversion circuit. And the same with delta S. So it's the heat of absorption and the entropy of absorption that are governing the compensation effect. Next slide, please. This is the front of the university building, Belfast, about 150 years old. It's a very nice, pleasant old building. The central campus. Next slide, please. That's the inner quad of it. It was in this corner, actually. The reason why I have this is that Thomas Andrews, the old chemistry labs were in here. Thomas Andrews did his famous experiments on the critical state of CO2. Next slide, please. This is Botanic Gardens, just right beside the university building. And this is a famous building architecture. We have the architect, the greenhouse. Go to the next slide, please. And this is just right under those Botanic Gardens. There's a statue of Lord Kelvin, Rhys Kelvin. Kelvin's name was Thompson. He was born and reared in Belfast and left at an early age and went over to Scotland. Professor in Glasgow. You just gone to? Yeah, that's it. That's it. Yeah, thanks very much. Thank you.
At this point, we still have time for some questions. Open up the floor for questions.
Quick question about that. What you just went over, the compensation effect.
Mm-hmm.
If that holds true, then you would see that the apparent activation energy of the reaction would vary with partial pressure, the agent partial pressure. Okay. If you have a heterogeneous
if you have a much richer regime of kinetics, things bound to the limiting form of the Langmuir equation will no longer hold. I'm running through here so rapidly, just assuming the limiting forms of the Langmuir equation get better, I guess. It can depend on what reactor. If you're doing a flow, if you're keeping a hydrogen, say, this is after it's doing, you see that's not going to be a dollar. You know. It's hydrogen chem absorption, I think. So the heat of hydrogen chem absorption is driving up its activation energy. The neopentane would be the positive order, the hydrogen would be negative order, if you go to notice.
So if you had something in the numerator of the kinetic rate law,
that's right.
A higher partial pressure would give you a lower apparent activation.
Well, it depends. No, it depends just on the equilibrium constant. As long as the limiting form Cx over Cy still holds, it won't hold forever, you see. You have to go back to the more developed forms of the Langmuir equation, and then you run into complications in terms of kinetics will change over